You guys ready? We will call the Public Works Committee to order for September 13th, 2017 with roll call.
Mr. Katura?
Here.
Mr. McGill?
Here.
Mr. Palunas?
Here. We have no changes to the agenda. We have one set of minutes from August the 2nd, 2017.
I move that we approve the minutes from August 2nd.
Second.
Proceed to vote.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mr. McGill?
Yes.
Mr. Palunas?
Yes. We have under pending, new, item number one, storm response status update.
Hello, gentlemen, and Patty, how's the committee today?
Good evening, or good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. Everybody good?
Yeah, how about you? How about you?
Okay, well, this is the Drainage Division's report, or the Sewer Division's report for August. For the month of August, the Service Department did our PM flood control on 91 North, 91 South, 43 East, and West, and our hotspot list, and what we like to do is we like to get out before a rain event or during a rain event, and we go through these specific areas. We see if there's anything that could cause a flood. We'll remove it, take the debris away, and thereby hopefully eliminating any kind of issue that could be. For the month of August, we had 1.89 inches of rain that fell. Last month's rain total was 4.5 inches, and that was a 2.26 inch down from last month. I'd like to report that in this month, all the inspection reports for the HOA and the ILO went out for everybody that has detention ponds and retention ponds. So we were able to send that out this month. Hopefully, I'll be getting some responses back. What we did, we went out early spring. We saw if there's any kind of issues. We denoted them on a report, and it's up to the residents to get them repaired. If they do make the repair, they would contact me, and we would reinspect it. For the month of August, the Service Department responded to 7 sewer calls. 6 of those were residential. 1 was a city issue, and it was easily remedied. We used the jet truck and removed some debris in a line. On our sanitary PM cleaning schedule, we completed Briar Hill, Tracy Lane, Woodsmore, Springside, Timothy Circle, and Ledge Hill. We also did 12 locations throughout the city for our PM response. Our sanitary cleaning upcoming locations are going to be Cannon Estates, Carrington Court, Mulberry, and Station Street. So we're making some good headway with that. For our storm PM cleaning, we completed Baldwin, Inwood, Linden, and Parkway. And the upcoming location will be Southside Park, and that will be starting next Monday. We also assisted with 12 work orders from the Pollution Control Department. Those are things that the Pollution Control Department wants us to look at, so we'll go there, we'll jet them, we'll clean them. We do a lot of lift stations for them, so we clean to the bottom, remove any kind of debris. Our camera crew responded to 44 locations around the city. And we completed 16 of our PM list for the month of August. Upcoming will be Jaga, Portage, Summit, and Willow Street. And we have 14 locations in September that we need to check. Our basement replacement program, we did 7 basins on Dorset Lane. And I just emailed the new list to the council to see where we'll be coming. We'll be on Solon Road, Bramble Lane, Winston Lane, and we're finishing up 1 on Dorset. Our excavation crew this month did 5 excavation jobs. We did 1 on Woodsdale, 1 on Harper Road. Turn a page. 1 on Dorset, 1 on Edgemore, and then on Country View, which I'll show you pictures, we replaced an old brick headwall with a new concrete headwall. For our sinkhole list, we investigated 15 sinkholes throughout the city. What we do, we go, we investigate, we dye test, and we'll fill them to grade. If we deem that it needs to be turned over to our grouting contractor, we'll put that on our grouting list. I also want to bring up that in the month of August, we started our sewer grouting contract with Lake County Sewer. There's going to be 33 locations with sewer pipes and 30 manholes that they're going to be inspecting, cleaning, and grouting. Our hydrant painting contractor started today. The following areas: Pettibone, Rolling Brook, Bainbridge Road, from Somme to the Bainbridge Line, Creekside, Cannon Estates, Ridge, Pine, and Birch. So that also started today. The fire department also is flushing the hydrants, and the residents can see that on the website on the fire department's page. Tracks construction completed. Namid Parkway, Richmond Road, which were two outstanding or out were two pending jobs that we needed to get done. So those two are also completed. Any questions so far?
Nice job. Your camera crew was in my neighborhood last week.
Oh, really?
So I got to watch them do their thing. Got to spend some time on the truck with them.
You know, it's
pretty impressive.
It's very interesting. It really is the things we can do now with the technology, and we're very blessed to have all that.
Yeah, no, they were very gracious to let me climb around. And
did they let you operate it?
Well, I tried, but they didn't. So just in case you're worried.
No, you can, you know.
I tried to say, how far can I get this thing to go before it runs out of cable? And
you know what? It's amazing what we can do now. It really is.
It's very impressive. So I thank them for that.
The first thing I want to show is this is the old head wall on Country View. And as you can see, it was an old brick head wall. It was probably about 20 years old, and it was starting to fall apart. There were cracks all over it. There were lateral and diagonal cracks, and it was becoming really unsafe, so we replaced it. So as we were pulling that out, we discovered that that's a 30-inch concrete pipe, and that was taking water from the creek, which is directly behind it. If you see this hose here, the creek runs right into that. So we took the bad section away, and we opened that up. So what we did is we had a piece of 30-inch back at the garage. We cut it, and we put the bell end on, which took us into the middle of the trench. The crew then poured a concrete collar around it. This is a 30-inch footer right here that goes from there to there, supporting the weight of the 30-inch concrete pipe. We used Simon forms to build a new head wall. These are one-piece forms. They make them to our measurement. We got the mechanical drawing from the engineering department, and we drew it out, and we sent the measurements to the company, and they sent us back the forms, and the crews put that together. Once it was done, we poured 18 inches of concrete, and then that was encased on top of the concrete pipe. And there's your finished product. And hopefully that will last another 25, 30 years. And we put some one-man stone in here for the erosion. As you can see, quite a bit of water flows out of that creek.
Nice work.
Nice job.
The crews did an excellent job on that. It was very impressive. I think it's only the second or third time that they used that type of forms. I know they did one a job with Mr. Dursick. That's only the second time. We have another one coming up probably the end of this month. It's going to be behind Ledge Hill. There's an old head wall that we have to replace. That one's going to be a little bit more challenging just logistically, but we're looking forward to that. Tracks Construction did some work for us, continued on with the work for us. This picture is a box culvert on Richmond Road by Valley Lane. A lot of water comes out of that when there is a rain event. It takes water from the surrounding communities. What had happened was that we had a lot of rain early spring, and all this stone here was actually pushed about 20 feet away, causing about a 5-foot sump or a 5-foot hole where the water was coming into. So tracks came in, they pushed all the stone back, rebuilt the walls. And now we normally do this every other year. That's something we have to do, just wear and tear with the water. The water is so strong that it pushes that stone. And this is the creek that runs behind Valley Lane. The last job they did for us this last month was Namid Parkway. And Namid Parkway, there is a force main and a water main that runs right through here. And it takes a lot of water coming down this little hill there. And there was a massive erosion issue. So what they did was they put larger stones underneath with the smaller stones on top. They put LSM concrete in there to stabilize it, covering the water line, covering the force main, and then they landscaped it. So I thought that came out really well. This is a view from the Bedford Heights side looking down. And that water will go down, it'll diffuse through the stone, and the creek is right in here, and it'll take the water. So that was all done by Tracks for us in August.
Okay.
So Super.
Any questions?
Very good work. Any questions from the committee?
Yeah. He had a productive month.
You know what? The guys do a great job. The drainage crew there, I'm very lucky. I have a lot of talented people there. And they enjoy the challenge, stuff like this. And we try to do the best we can. Some months, not as much as others, but this was a good month for us. And we're looking forward to the next month when we tackle that the larger head wall behind Ledge Hill.
Oh, that was a nice month. Thanks, Mike.
Thank you.
Okay, we'll move on to item number two, City of Solon Infrastructure Improvement Report. Good evening, John. How are you?
Good evening or good afternoon, however it might be. Since last month, just to update the committee on our monthly infrastructure construction report, we had expenditures under our priority one projects. We had expenditures to our Cochrane Road Phase 2 project as well as our Copley Avenue reconstruction project. Moving down into our priority two projects, we awarded our asphalt repair program. We had expenditures to our concrete annual repair program as well as our street striping program. And then moving down into our priority three projects, we had expenditures in all of those categories, those being the construction inspection, design services, engineering chargebacks, updates, as well as materials testing, and work was done under our emergency and miscellaneous traffic signal repair program. If there's any questions from the committee, I can address those now.
Any questions for John?
That's good.
Okay, seeing none, we'll move on to item number three, the proposed infrastructure annual budget. We did receive a memorandum from Mr. Robino via email. I think we also got a paper copy regarding the procedure for the budget in December. And we're going to have the budget hearings before the end of the year again this year. And this is our proposed budget for the priority one, priority two, and priority three for 2018. And John, if you would like to just briefly, or do you want to briefly go through it?
I can, and I guess just before we get into the all the items that were being proposed for 2018, I just wanted to let the committee know that I did have some preliminary discussions with Mr. Rubino prior to this meeting, just to let him know that I was going to start this preliminary process with the committee, most likely for this meeting as well as into at least October, moving into the rest of the budget hearings. The committee has our preliminary infrastructure improvement project budget before them tonight. It's set up in the same format that we've set up these budgets before, in a priority one, two, and three process. Priority ones being the projects that we would like to recommend as the first priorities, and two and three accordingly. Those projects that we are recommending under our priority ones, some of those are carryovers from last year that have not moved forward for one reason or another. Some of those projects, the projects that we have under our priority ones are the Samarora intersection, the city's portion is $1,889,320. The second project is another carryover from last year's budget, our Briar Hill Drive culvert replacement. That budget is budgeted at $325,000. The Preserve Subdivision Stormwater Modification Phase 3. The Solon Road sidewalk project from Davis Industrial to Aurora Road. That project was put on hold this year because of we were in the process of pursuing one right-of-way from one property earlier in the year, and then Dominion East Ohio proposed a gas betterment project, which was going to go right through this area. So when we realized that if we would put this sidewalk in, the sidewalk would be torn out as a result of the project, we just opted to put this on hold till the gas project's completed. The Sharondale Storm Sewer Project is another one that's carryover from last year. We were finally able to secure the easement that we needed from that parcel. And as Since this project is budgeted from on this year's budget as well, if time allows and weather allows, we still are going to plan to proceed with that project and do the construction as the weather may allow. If not, we'll carry it forward onto this budget in 2018. The Valley Forge stream restoration project, I guess I'm going to steal some of my thunder from the from upcoming agenda items, but we did receive funding for this project that the committee and council allowed us to apply for funding for through the Ohio EPA 319 grant program, and this represents the city's portion to that grant in the amount of $110,000. The next project, Sherwood Drive culvert replacement, this was a culvert replacement project that we had again budgeted for this year. We're planning to do that project in-house, and as time and weather allow, we will still plan to pursue finalizing those plans and moving forward with the construction yet this year. If not, we'll carry it over to 2018. The next one is the Derby Downs Drive reconstruction project in the estimated amount of $1,800,000. We have a proposed city tree planting program for Bainbridge Road and Miles Road in the amount of $120,000. I'm also proposing to do a reconstruction of the Carter Street in the amount of $2,500,000 and replace a sanitary sewer on Woodsdale. This is in the amount of $88,000. This would be to replace one section that is in need of repair just based on age and condition. Moving down into our priority two projects, this is where we typically show a lot of our annual programs that we have listed here. The committee's well very familiar with these, those being our concrete repair program, our asphalt repair program, street striping, our sanitary and storm system repair program, which is already out for bid, as well as is our emergency and miscellaneous roadway repair program, as those follow the calendar year. And the 2017 programs will expire at the end of 2017. So those two programs are already out for bid in preparation to be in place for January 1st, 2018. Some of those other programs under the priority twos are our preventative maintenance, our sewer grouting, and one new one, which is will be an annual catch basin repair program. And this program, we've done this in the past and not for several years because Bill and his staff have been doing a lot of these catch basin repairs through the service department, and the gentleman that has done those, is my understanding, is be retiring at the end of this year. So I think until Bill would get somebody else in place to do that work in-house, we're going to accommodate those repairs through an annual program. Moving down into our priority threes, again, these are a lot of our assistance programs, such as our construction inspection, our design services, engineering chargebacks, materials testing, and our emergency and traffic signal repairs. If there's any specific questions from the committee, I can address those now.
Well, I just have a request for the next meeting.
Yes.
If we could have a proposed, if you can get it from finance, how much is going to be anticipated to be put into the infrastructure fund.
Okay.
So we can see how much is going to be put in from the tax collections, and then so we can extrapolate those numbers and look at to make sure these numbers are realistic and make sure these numbers are in line with what we're going to have put into the infrastructure fund. Also, any type of balance that we have in that fund, that's a carryover balance from 2017 anticipated. And the other thing is on, and we'll go through line by line at the next meeting, for if we want to modify this or change it. But I think on priority two projects, item number five, I want to make sure that number is going to be enough or accurate even for the emergency and miscellaneous roadway repair. So Dan, if you can just go through the past, you know, 3 years and just average the numbers out to make sure that this is, you know, a realistic number, because if we have a lot of water main breaks or a lot of other issues that we have to do on an emergency basis, I want to make sure that we are covered under that with the budget.
Actually, Dan, if you could expand on that a little bit, and for the last 3 years, sir, budget versus actual numbers. that would be great, so we can see how good we are, especially on these recurring projects.
Sure.
All right, thank you.
Anyone from the committee have anything else on this? Mark.
John, with respect to priority one, number three, the preserve.
Yes.
Did we, where are we with the permit?
We submitted the permit.
Are we further along in that process?
We submitted the permit, and the Army Corps of Engineers has asked us to go back and more or less reevaluate or pretty much redesign everything, because they have said that our initial request was too impactful. So that's where we're at, and we're hopeful to get back to that and resubmit something back to them for further consideration.
Okay.
One of the problems with this project, obviously, is it is a wetland, and as a result, it's wet. So it's this construction is, even if we do have a couple of dry weeks, it's still going to be a very time-consuming and wet and very difficult project.
The other question I had was with respect to the sidewalks. And we would postpone that for the gas company's project.
Oh, the Solon Road sidewalks?
Correct.
Yes.
Did the gas company complete that project?
They just submitted their final plans to us this week, and so the construction actually hasn't even started yet.
Okay. So there's a possibility then that they might not even be done.
A possibility could arise that they may not even be done well into next year. So probably at the very best, I would think this would be a late 18 project for us.
And do we have an idea yet, as part of our priority two in the concrete repair program? That's where we do our sidewalk repair program out of,
yes.
Correct?
Yes.
Do we have any idea yet as to how much we may allocate of that $2 million to sidewalks? It just seems like we're having more and more of the sidewalk issues in some of the older subdivisions.
I did look a little bit at that coming into today's meeting, and because I did actually consider the idea of maybe doing an individual sidewalk repair program separate from the concrete repair program. At this point, it didn't appear as if those numbers were that far out of whack, that, I mean, quantity-wise and request-wise, that we would have to address sidewalks in that way. I'll have some more information for you on that at the next meeting.
Okay. Thank you.
I think, yeah, from what Mark said, I also, if we can look at the concrete repair program, because sometimes what we might want to do is we might want to break it down at some point, have it all under concrete repair, obviously, but break it down how much we're going to put into concrete leveling for sidewalks, how much we're going to put into street repair, those types of different things, curbs, gutters. Just so we know approximately what we're going
sure.
to be doing.
Sure.
Okay, we'll get into this a little bit more next meeting, so we'll hang on to this, and if we can get the additional information, and then we'll look forward to. Well, Mark?
I did have one other question.
Sure.
Yes.
And correct me if I'm wrong, didn't we use some of the excess miscellaneous roadway repair program funds for additional pavement work last year? Did we not, Dan?
I don't believe that we did anything very much with regard to that. That there might have been one or two locations near the end of the year that we might have added on, but I didn't go do like.
So that my point was, I thought I remember us doing something towards the end of the year. So I just was going to make sure, you know, Mr. McGill had made the request for comparing. I think it was Mr. McGill.
Yeah.
Comparing budget versus actual. And I just, in those instances, perhaps maybe that would be an outlier that maybe we need to put an asterisk by to adjust the numbers for. So that's, I just wanted to bring that up.
I have the breakdowns by locations on an Excel spreadsheet, so it's real easy to pick it apart.
Thank you.
Good. Thanks, Dan. Okay.
Thank you. So we'll look forward to, getting those numbers next month. And we'll move on to item number four, Citywide Traffic Improvements Project, Contract 2010.20, final closeout. We have a memorandum from Councilperson Nancy Meany, Ward 5, and she's expressing her concern regarding the passage of the final closeout for the Traffic Signal Improvement Project. I did speak with her via text or email earlier today, and I have no issue in holding this until the next meeting if it's okay with the committee, because Nancy did raise some concerns regarding to the functionality of the system, and she had some concerns about closing out the contract. John, did you see the memorandum?
No, I have not.
I'll just read it to you?
Certainly.
Okay. I want to express my concern regarding the passage of the final closeout for the Traffic Signal Improvement Project. Although I plan on attending the meeting, I want to make you aware of my concern prior to the meeting. And she is here, and I think her concern is that the, to summarize her concern, is that the system, she's received complaints that the system's not working properly. Some lights are not, the timing of lights and the cameras appear to not be working properly to move traffic flow, and she's concerned. So she's asking us to hold the final closeout until her concerns are addressed. Is that pretty much it? Name and address, please.
Nancy Meany, 5185 Harper Road. You know, to be honest with you, John, I would rather wait to go through the winter and see how these new cameras and how everything functions. I mean, I just received an email that I just looked at from Carrie of two of the issues. I know one is Harper Cannon, where the turn signals are going and nobody's in those. She just responded back to me that that was due to an accident. The shopping center by the Burger King, you can turn left in the Burger King, nobody's in that lane, but you can't seem to turn, there's no left signal for the people wanting to go to the shopping center. And she says right in here, Perm's involved, GPD, and I just think because we got the new cameras, and if you can tell me any different reason not to, personally, I would rather wait to go through the winter. Let's see, because this is where we ran into all the problems the last time, was with some stuff in the winter, and I just, you know, want to make sure, and I'm still, like I say, I'm still hearing from people, and I myself am experiencing it. So those are my comments.
John, are you okay with it?
I'm fine with it. I just think I'll need to talk to the law director to see what his thoughts will be about and how we would proceed, obviously, with the contractor in holding this, if the city, to see if there might be any issues from the contractor relative to additional funds for him carrying forward the bonds and the maintenance bond if the city holds it.
Well, we want to make sure that because we, I know we got when the heaters broke on the,
yes,
when the heaters broke or malfunctioned or weren't working properly as designed, we got an extra warranty on that, and we got all the heaters replaced, correct?
Yes, we had all the cameras have been replaced. All of those cameras that we had the issue with initially have all been removed and replaced.
So I think that it is because of the issues, I think that there should still, I don't know if there is any incremental cost on it.
As of right now, there has been no incremental cost,
so because the city
hasn't accepted it to date. So whenever the date is,
this
starts the process.
So if we wait a couple months, it's not going to be.
And it may not be an issue, but I just want to have the discussion with the law director just to let him know.
Okay.
See if he has any issues. The city, this starts the acceptance process. Just from the administration standpoint, all we're saying is we're ready to start the acceptance process. I understand we have some issues that Ms. Meany raised. But even after the acceptance date of the project, we still have a two-year bond in place to address issues.
I understand that. So what we'll do is we can hold this here, and then what we'll probably end up doing is we'll hold this because of Nancy's concerns. What we'll probably do is review it. You'll talk to the law director. That'll take us to December, okay? Or it'll take you for him to get a response. Then what we'll do is, once we get that response, we'll then, we could then review the response, forward it to council at that point, and then have council have three readings on it, on the closeout if necessary, okay. And that gives us a little, even more time. So there's not a hurry, because we still have to follow through with our processes here.
Very good.
Mark?
I would just like to say I don't think the Councilwoman Meany has the patent on the only one having concerns with respect to the closeout. I have concerns myself. Some of the concerns that I had were, we did have problems, it seemed like, during the winter. And so I'm glad that she brought that up. Mrs. Meany was on the Public Works Committee, I think, when this project started. And initially, I think we had problems where heaters were not plugged in. Then heaters were overheating, I think. Then I believe the actual camera detection systems, I think we, correct me if I'm wrong, they were to be replaced. It seemed like only half of them got replaced. Every time we seemed to have an issue, it was like, well, that's in an area where we haven't replaced the camera yet. So it just felt like, from my perspective, that the cameras never all got fully replaced during the winter season. So as I'm sitting here, I am apprehensive as well. I share the same concerns that Mrs. Meany does, and it's kind of like, I feel, I understand that we have a warranty and everything, mm-hmm. but I still feel as though if we were to purchase a car, and we went and took it for a test drive, and the car kept stalling and the check engine light came on, we could still buy it saying, well, you've got a warranty. So I kind of feel the same way, and I am not 100% comfortable moving forward tonight on this as well.
Do you have a specific list from Councilwoman Meany on the issues that she's concerned about? A checklist of things you need to...
I'm aware of three intersections. One is the Cannon Harper.
Yeah.
One is the Burger King at Aurora, mm-hmm. and I think the third one was, and correct me if I'm wrong, Harper and Aurora, which was I think that one was a timing one. Those are the only three that I'm aware of.
Yeah, just Harper Road keep coming up here.
I was gonna save it for my update later, but Harper Cannon intersection was on August 31st was involved. There was a two-car accident there that as a result of the accident, the traffic cabinet was hit and ripped off of its foundation. All the wires were severed, and I have some pictures with my other stuff at my desk I could show you. I'll save those for the update. But as a result of that, the contractor came out and put a temporary cabinet in. Obviously, it's not up to the same standards that we had in there permanently. So until we get a new cabinet in place, that signal is going to function in a recall mode.
All right. Now, when was the original date for this project to be finished?
The original date goes back... the original completion date was the end of 2014.
Okay. Does the have all cameras been replaced or just some?
Yes, and to what Mark Councilman Couture had said, all the cameras right now have been replaced. As of last winter, not all of the cameras had been replaced because all of the cameras have been replaced.
And the warranty on those is what?
Two years from the final date of acceptance.
So the acceptance date triggers the warranty?
Yes.
Okay. So at this point in time, we don't have any warranty issues. And there is a bond, as I heard you say that as well.
Yes. The maintenance bond is, per our contract, is 10% of the contract cost.
And when does that bond get utilized?
If we would have a maintenance issue during the two-year maintenance period.
Okay, so that's how they intended paying for it.
Yeah.
All right. Do they control that, the vendor, or does
the bond is addressed to the city of Solon.
Okay, so that's under our control.
Yes.
All right.
Okay. Thanks, Bob. Anything further? Mm-hmm. Okay, so what we'll do is We will just, do you want to do a, why don't we, just to make it official, why don't we do a motion to table? I'll move to table.
Second.
Proceed to vote.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mr. McGale?
Yes.
Mr. Pelonis?
Yes. Moving on, Nancy, you might not want to leave it. Brainerd Road Culvert Replacement, C1 Project, Contract 2013.25. Final closeout, and the contract is in the amount of $4,689,928. And this extends the final completion date of the project to June 8th, 2017.
That's the wrong legislation.
I think you're still on the citywide.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry. Sorry about that. I was on the wrong one. This is Brainerd Road Culvert Replacement Project, 2013.25, original contract, and the final contract, $238,019.82. I apologize.
Yes, really nothing.
Thank you, Mark.
Nothing out of the ordinary to report to the committee here. The original contract amount was $240,811.75. We used almost all of the full contract amount of this. Came in $2,791.93 less than the original contract amount. And there was one previous change order on this contract for the restoration of the grass, which we have accepted. So with that, we're asking for the committee's consideration to close this out as the in the amount of the $238,019.82.
All right, I move request legislation be prepared to close out contract 2013.25 in the amount of $238,019.82.
Second.
Second. Thank you. Any discussion? Proceed to vote.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mr. McGill?
Yes.
Mr. Pelonis?
Yes. Moving on to item number six, Cochran Road Reconstruction Phase 1, 2015.26 contract, final closeout. Final amount is $1,456,882.44, and it is less than the original contract due to all the quantities have not been used.
Yes, that's correct. There was one change order that the committee and council had approved in the amount of $17,812.50. That was for the installation of conduit and pull boxes for a future extension of our city fiber system to ultimately connect the water rec department to our city fiber network. But other than that, we did come under contract. The breakdown of the quantities is provided to the committee, as well as a final contractor evaluation. And we were requesting that this contract be closed out in the final construction amount of $1,456,882.44.
Okay, any questions from the committee? Seeing none, is there a motion?
I'd like to make a motion to prepare legislation that approves the final change order for the Cochran Road Reconstruction Phase 1 project, contract 2015.26, which will reduce the contract by $129,461.06 and closes the contract out in the amount of $1,456,882.44.
I second.
Second, thank you. Any discussion? Proceed to vote.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mr. McGill?
Yes.
Mr. Pelonis?
Yes. Okay, moving on to item number seven, we have the 2016 annual concrete repair contract 2016.03, final closeout, the amount of $1,606,268.14. John?
Again, we're requesting final closeout of our 2016 annual concrete repair program with Trimore Corporation. The final contract amount was $1,606,268.14. A breakdown of the final cost and quantity, as well as the contractor evaluation, are attached for the committee's consideration.
Okay. Any questions? Is there a motion?
I request legislation be prepared to close contract 2016.03, final closeout in the amount of $1,606,268.14.
Second.
Thank you. Discussion. Proceed to vote.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mr. McGill?
Yes.
Mr. Palunas?
Yes. Moving on to item number 8, 2016 Annual Emergency and Miscellaneous Roadway Repair, contract 2016.12. Final closeout in the amount of $166,607.86. John, anything?
If the committee wanted a comparison of awarded versus actual, here we are as a
yes.
Thank you.
As one, so you'll be probably seeing these numbers again next month. But we are requesting to close this contract out in the final contract amount of $166,607.86. The final breakdown of the cost and final numbers of the cost and quantity, as well as the contract evaluation, are attached for the committee's consideration.
Okay. Are there any questions from the committee? So the original contract was $294,675. So that's the number to compare to for next year.
Yes.
And then the realistic number is the 166.
$166,607.86, yes.
It's a complex finance term.
All right, thank you.
Okay, is there a motion?
Sure. I would like to make a motion to prepare legislation that approves the final change order, the 2016 Annual Emergency and Miscellaneous Roadway Repair Program Contract 2016.12. which reduces the contract by $128,067.14 and closes the contract in the amount of $166,607.86.
Second.
Proceed to vote.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mr. McGill?
Yes.
Mr. Palunas?
Yes. Next item is the item number 9. The General Engineering Services Contract 2018.15, and what the engineering department is looking at renewing the contract with our current General Design Engineering Services contractor, and requesting RFQs from various firms. Correct, John?
Yes. Our current contract with Burgess and Nyepel, who currently holds this general engineering services contract, expires in 2000 or at the end of 2017. This current contract will be finishing our second year with this current contract. To date, we've been very satisfied with Burgess and Nyepel as our general engineering services consultant. And if the committee would consider this, we would propose just to renegotiate and renew our contract with them. But obviously, if the committee does not want to move forward in that manner, we would just request authorization to move forward with our standard qualifications process.
Mark?
I just wanted to say, you know, since I've been on the committee, that's 4 years now, it seems like Burgess and Nyepel had the contract for 2 years. We went through the RFQ process, and they were deemed to be the most qualified again. So I can't believe it's been another 2 years already. It seems like they know the lay of the land in the city. They've been doing a lot of work here. I would think that there is a learning curve that would be involved with whoever we would use. I think it's important to note that under the Ohio Revised Code, it's not like we're sending this out to bid. First, the way the municipal world works, you have to, when you were going for a professional service like this, the Ohio Revised Code makes us go through this qualified selection-based process to deem which vendor would be the absolute most qualified, correct?
Yes, correct.
And then after that decision has been deemed, then you go through the process to see who's qualified, then you negotiate pricing. It kind of seems a little backwards. But I am comfortable, having worked with them now for 4 years, I am comfortable with just having the engineering department, as long as they are as comfortable as I am with them, to just reach out to them and to begin the negotiating the price.
I am comfortable representing the department to move forward in that manner. Obviously, if I wasn't, I wouldn't recommend that to the committee.
How many different vendors, general engineering service vendors, have you worked with?
We've worked with several. Years ago, before we did this general engineering services contract, we did this qualification process for each individual project. So,
Each project, okay.
Yes, so you can imagine going through this qualification selection process for each project. So we've worked with several vendors.
And so at some point you decided you'd sign a general contract and then propose each project underneath the auspices.
Yes, it was quite a time
contract.
Savings for us.
Okay. So you have worked with several different vendors as well, and in your personal opinion, this is, you think, a good arrangement for the city?
It is.
Okay. So is there a motion from the committee?
We don't need legislation for that. You just need authorization from us to do this, right?
We need authorization to renegotiate the contract for the next 2 years.
Yeah, I would request the committee add into their legislation to waive the qualification process and authorize us to renegotiate our contract.
All right, so we do need to formally waive the process.
Yes.
Okay, you all right with that?
Sure.
I'd like to propose legislation be prepared waiving the authorization process or the qualification process for Burgess and Nyepel and empowering the engineering department to negotiate a new 2-year contract with them for general engineering services.
Second.
Discussion, proceed to vote.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mr. McGill?
Yes.
Mr. Perunas?
Yes. Moving on to item number 10, we have a Valley Forge Headwater Stream Bank Restoration Grant. And the estimated project cost was $275,000 with $110,000 local match. And there was a grant which was $165,000, $110,000 local match. The grant agreement was reviewed by the law director and it includes $8,750 maximum for administrative fees to manage the grant paperwork. Is that pretty much standard, John?
Yes, and just to update refresh the committee's memory, this is the same funding program that the city performed the St. Mary's Stream Restoration Project under a couple years ago. Same Ohio EPA 319 grant. We did have similar funds in that grant for Chagrin River Watershed Partners to assist us with the paperwork, which includes quarterly updates to the EPA on the status of the project, as well as final closeout paperwork. So in that regard, they are very beneficial with helping us with a lot of the paperwork. This project that the committee and council had allowed us to submit for under this Ohio EPA grant program was to do a stream restoration project of this headwater stream here, which is east of Liberty Road, which this is Liberty Road. This is Valley Forge Lane here, and this is Independence Court. And a lot of this project and this ultimate application and funding for this project ultimately stemmed from a study the city had done years ago for some slope stability issues relative to the Valley Forge subdivision. So this project is kind of, I think the study was done almost 10 years ago. So I guess this is, this grant and this project is kind of a final commitment to the city's, or a final commitment of the city's willingness to do what was recommended and committed to by the city from that study years ago.
Well, the grant's nice. When you talk about the stream restoration project, what's involved in that?
Obviously, every stream is different, but a lot of times and specifically what we're looking at here is over time, the stream has eroded the embankment down to where there's very tall sheer banks in certain areas, as much as probably 10 feet from the top of the slope to the stream bed. Mm-hmm. And those will continue to cut down unless the stream is restored and brought back up to its original condition and original elevations. One of the other things, I remember when we brought this application back to the committee, I had showed a picture of that this stream actually had eroded all the way back to the head wall here at this culvert at Liberty Road, and that was one of the other reasons why I was recommending that we do this project so that it wouldn't continue to undermine the culvert at Liberty Road.
Any other questions? Mm-hmm. Entertain any motions?
And I would like to make them in response to Engineer Bush's memo to the Public Works Committee dated September 6, 2017 regarding the Valley Forge Headwater Stream Bank Restoration Grant. I'd like to make a motion that prepares legislation to accept an Ohio EPA Clean Water Act grant and to authorize the mayor to execute all paper and furtherance of grant.
Second.
Thank you. Any discussion? Proceed to vote.
Mr. Ventura?
Yes.
Mr. McGill?
Yes.
Mr. Palunas?
Yes. Thank you, John.
Thank you.
Moving on to item number 11, we have amendment to the annual materials testing program, ordinance 2017-45. We have a memorandum from Paul Solonix, Director of Water Reclamation, and the estimate of the cost of the retired testing is $35,000, and there's $30,000 remaining on the contract, so this would increase the total amount of the contract from $66,700 to $80,000. Is that correct, Paul?
Correct.
And if you'd like to just briefly explain what the project entails.
Yeah, this is related to our preliminary treatment improvement project, and throughout the course of the project, they're going to have to do materials testing. As you mentioned, it's going to, you know, we asked Arcadis about how much money that was going to cost. They estimated about $35,000. Obviously, when I found out it was that much money, I was going to need to do something because of the amount of money that was going to be to get this taken care of. So we knew that we had a materials testing contract already with the city, but I obviously didn't want to deplete their whole amount of money that they had to set aside for their projects. So I met with Matt Rubino, John, and Mr. Lobey, the law director, just to see what they thought about how we would go about doing this project. There were some things that are going to be done under the course of our contract that weren't covered in the original contract. So after our meeting, we discussed the best solution would be to go ahead and amend this contract, get a proposal from GeoSci for the various tests that weren't covered in the current contract, which was grout testing, shotcrete testing, concrete coring testing, and the rebar and epoxy pull testing. So I did attach that quote. In that quote, they agreed to honor all the terms and conditions of the original contract. So more or less, this is just a quote for these specific items that weren't mentioned in the original contract. And again, we increased the amount just because I know John and Dan have some items that are still slated to be paid out of that account and didn't want to completely deplete that account. The other thing we wanted to do was also extend the time period of the contract, because once you get a materials testing company involved, you want to maintain that company throughout the course of the project. So that's the reason why I was requesting an extension to December 2018.
Okay, any questions for Paul? Is there a motion?
I would like to prepare legislation to modify ordinance number 2017-45 to increase the total amount by $13,300 to $80,000 and to extend the time of the contract from April 2018 to December 31st, 2018.
Second.
Second. Any discussion? Proceed to vote.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mr. McGill?
Yes.
Mr. Palunas?
Yes. Thank you, Paul.
I failed to mention one other thing, too, is that, you know, that money that originally came under that agreement was slated to be pulled out of the engineering fund. So through finance, we're going to encumber some of the money from the Water Reclamation Department budget to pay out, obviously, my portion of the testing.
Understood.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Moving on to item number 12, ordinance 1060.08, change in time for placing rubbish and recycling containers. Good evening, Mr. Jurcik.
Good evening. I'm bringing this forward to change the time that the rubbish has to be out on the curb from 7:30 to 7 o'clock. Our summer hours at the service department are from 7 a.m. to 3:30, and it seems that a lot of times this year we're having a problem with late stops because our trucks are getting there before the 7:30 put out time. So I'm requesting from the committee that we change the start time to get the rubbish out from 7:30 to 7 a.m. I did run this by our law department, Mr. Lobey, and he was okay with it. And as you can see, is attached to the memo is a copy of the ordinance to change it from 7:30 to 7 a.m.
Okay. Is it going to be I don't think it's going to be a issue for residents for the half hour difference, because a lot of people do put it out put out the garbage at night.
Yeah, most of the residents put it out the night before.
Do you know a percentage or anything else?
Well, we probably end up, I mean, there's probably about 10 to 15 late stops a day. It's not a whole lot, but it the time it takes for the truck to have to go back to the stop after they're completed with their route, and they're spotted all over that day's route. So it's just not a matter of 5 or 10 on one street or random throughout that particular day's route.
Well, the question that I have is, how are we going to make sure that, you know, we're going to have to really if we're going to change this, we're going to have to really publicize it and set a start date for a date far enough certain so everyone can be notified and everyone can know that the time has been switched, because we don't want to have people, you know, for a week or two and then have your staff have to keep coming out and have late stops.
Well, the plan is to put out a general publicized announcement to all the residents stating this, basically taking effect the first of the year, because we would also like to accompany a newsletter. So as we have our first full week of the month HHW collection, we would like to take the white goods and some of the extra stop rubbish and move that to the first full week of the month. That way it frees up staff to do some other things, such as keep up with the brush pickup and be able to put extra staff on, you know, cold patch or hot patch throughout the summer and do some additional work. So that would be a whole newsletter would go out that we would have the council review before it was sent out.
Okay, I just want to make sure that the residents would have, you know, enough notice so they would know exactly what need, because everyone really knows now what time garbage needs to go out. And this is really a core city function that we're providing. And if we're changing the way we're providing it by saying we're going to start a half hour earlier, we need to really make sure that people know about this and are okay with it.
Right. Well, the notices were planning to go out sometime in December, so they would have a whole month in order to prepare for the first of the year for the rubbish to be switched to 7 o'clock. And then we would, our winter hours are 7:30 to 4, so we would be able to educate those residents that are putting it out late in that first part of the year, so when we do change the summer hours in April, that everybody would be on board.
So when would be a proposed or anticipated start date for this?
For the change in the ordinance would be the first of the year.
Okay. So we'd have a few months to notify everyone and
correct
discuss it. What does the committee think about everything?
I mean, I understand what he wants to do and why.
Yeah. But when you change a schedule,
we're going to hear about it.
That's the thing. When you change a schedule, especially something that affects, even though it's only a half hour.
Right.
And I understand the administrative, everything that's going on. When you change a schedule for residents, half hour earlier garbage pickup, it might not seem like a big deal at the committee level, but I'd like to get some input from residents on this, because we're the ones who hear about any types of changes, and this affects every single resident in the city.
What I would suggest, and this truly is a suggestion, that, you know, you send something out in November and solicit feedback, and then report to us in December what you have heard back from residents and from how many. And that way we can see whether this is something that's going to be a significant problem, or it's just two or three people that are going to be inconvenienced.
Because I know sometimes, and I know you wanted to answer, but I know sometimes what Mr. McGill said here is that when you have certain residents, sometimes people have, they don't subscribe to our senior, the senior assistance program, so they might have someone coming over to bring garbage out, and that person might come over at 7:15 in the morning or 7. There might be quite a few people that are affected in that way, and I think what he said really has a lot of weight to it, because we really don't want to. We're doing this to alleviate some strain on the staff too for other issues, but I think that we really need to make sure we're doing this the right way if we're going to do it.
Yeah, no, we need to have feedback, and you know, some people will perceive it as we're doing this for our benefit and not for theirs.
No, I understand that, but instead of sending that letter out, say November, could we do that in October?
Sure.
And send it in October. That'll give us more time to calculate, you know, to tabulate everything.
That'd be great.
And the feedback, and we could even maybe put something back, you know, send a letter out and have them be able to do it, say via email back. That way, you know, they don't necessarily have to do it in writing. It could be sent back via email.
Yeah, we'll make sure everybody has the right email address. It's wdursick at...
That, or we can set up a generic one through, say, IT department.
Okay.
But, so, what? Just so we can clarify, what are we actually going to be doing now? We're going to...
We'll send a letter out at the end of September to ask for feedback from the residents on if they would be all right with changing the time from 7:30 to 7, and we'll include, I'll get with Mr. Gibbs from IT, and we'll put together some kind of a email address for the people to respond to, or they could send a letter back to us, and that way we have some information coming back so we can make a better educated decision.
Yeah, that'd be great. I'd like to hear the results of that before we go to the final.
If we send that out, say, the end of September, then we have the month of October to collect the data. That way, the first meeting in November, we can come back with the information.
That'd be great.
That sounds perfect. And when you send the letter out, if you could send us a copy of the letter so that we know it went out, because we'll probably get questions from residents asking about the letter they received. So we'd like to have some advance notice that it went out.
Okay.
Great.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you.
Thanks, Bill.
Moving on to item number 13.
Council Chair Balunas, can I request one thing? I'm just thinking about going back to my legislation. I failed to request an emergency clause in that statement tonight.
For national, yeah, for his.
For the materials testing program?
Yeah.
Okay, I will move to amend the ordinance that was previously passed by this committee to include the emergency clause for the reason that the construction is currently
underway,
and it's absolutely necessary for this materials testing program to be completed in order for the construction to continue.
Second.
Proceed to vote.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mr. McGill?
Yeah.
Mr. Balunas?
Yes.
Thank you.
No problem. Moving on to correspondence, item number 13. We received correspondence, actually came to me and I forwarded it to the committee, from Lorne and Ethan Miller at 6722 Solon Boulevard. And Ms. Miller is here this evening. And I did speak with her and I told her what we were going to do. We received the correspondence. I did speak with Mr. Dursick about this via telephone. And at this point, I told her that we were probably not going to take any action tonight. What we're going to do tonight is just refer this over to the law department and engineering and service so we can get all their records. Well, first of all, we're going to refer it to the law department for them to give us a legal opinion on, because this is way above the morals claims amount, is what you're requesting. And we're also going to send it to the engineering department and to Mr. Dursick just to get a history from them and a copy of their records so that we can have all the file information and everything else that's been done to date, and so we can create a timeline. We'll come back this committee again, and once we get that, we'll review that, and we'll have you and your husband be able to ask some questions and comment and everything else. So is that okay with Bill?
Yes.
So yes, what we're
we've already began to prepare to pull some of the records, so it should not be an issue, and we'll schedule some time with the law director.
Okay, so what we'll do is we won't take any formal action tonight, but we'll would someone like to make a motion to refer it, or would that be okay? Or I can make the motion.
I have a quick question, though. Lauren. You've paid for all these bills at this point.
If you could come up to the microphone, please. Thank you. Just for the record, coming up to the microphone is Lauren Miller, 6722 Solon Boulevard.
We have paid for all of the bills except the lawn repair one. So if you have the letter I had sent, we've paid for the plumbing costs already, the tree removal, the roof damage, but not yet the lawn repair. We had received a quote from the company, and they had said to wait to let the lawn settle first with the snowfall and the rain. And so we are waiting to actually have that service completed before we pay.
Okay, so but you, out of your personal accounts or credit cards, you've absorbed the cost of this to this date?
That's correct, except for the lawn repair.
And that the number you quoted to us is $10,366?
That's correct.
Based upon the invoices you have received from these different companies?
Correct.
Okay. My question is, and that's really for the committee, is that you know, they're paying something in credit card fees as well as, you know, everything else relative to this. So if they're asking for this amount, we may want to do something else to help them cover the cost of all of the financing relative to this.
Well, I don't know if we legally can do that. I don't think we can legally do that, because I think the issue is that anytime there's any type of a claim against the city, I think we can pay some incidental expenses, mm-hmm. but I don't think we can pay finance charges or interest on certain types of claims. So there might be an issue with that. But I think that at this point we're not even there yet. We have to establish whether there's liability on behalf of the city first, and then what we have to do is we then have to, you know, get all the information. The law department will establish whether there's liability on behalf of the city. Mr. Jurcik will get us all the information, and at that point, then what we'll do is we'll evaluate all that information, and then we'd refer it over to the finance committee with a recommendation, mm-hmm. for what we would recommend doing. So if we went through all the information and we said we feel there's a valid claim, we would then say we feel there's a valid claim based on this, this, and this from Mr. Jurcik and from everyone else, and then we would recommend that the finance committee consider it for payment. If we feel that there's not an existing claim or there's not a good claim, then what we would do is we could say the law director said there's no claim as a matter of law, and we would refer it over to the finance committee on a moral claim basis, mm-hmm. which would be under our code and our administrative code. So we would do it that way, and then there's a cap on the moral claim. So, but we need to really take it at the first step. So I'm not being negative or I'm not being pessimistic here on the value of the claim or any type of legalities here, but I think we just need to get it over to the law department, have Mr. Jurcik get us the information, and then next month we'll be able to look at that and then determine which direction we're going to go.
Will that decision be made at the October meeting? Or would it just be more of a discussion at the October
meeting? I think we'll have a discussion at the mm-hmm. October meeting, but I can't say a decision will be made mm-hmm. because we need to get the opinion from the law director, so they need to get us a memo. Typically, they would get us a memo within that period of time. But there would be no final decision that night, because we would still have to refer it over to finance. If we sided with what your claim is, and we referred it over to finance, finance would meet for probably another 2 weeks, and then it would have to go to council. So there's still a process involved here, but we're starting the process.
I understand.
We're starting the process, so I can't say that if we decided at the next meeting, and I'm not saying which direction we're going to go, that you would be able to, you know, get a check the next day or something like that. So it's anytime you deal with government, it's always a process. But we're going through the process.
Okay.
and we'll answer any questions you have in the meantime.
All right, so you'll have that prepared for us, including the law opinion by the next meeting?
I believe we should be able to have that. We have a meeting set up with the law department tomorrow.
All right, thanks, Bill.
Okay.
I have a question.
Mark, go ahead.
Mrs. Miller, do you know when your house was constructed?
1952.
And when did you move in?
We moved in 8 years ago, around Halloween, so 2009.
Okay.
October 31st.
I'll ask. Yeah, we weren't really going to discuss this tonight, but I'll just ask you one question because I might forget it. When you moved into your home, did you have any type of a residential disclosure statement? Can you get us a copy of that if you have one?
I'll have to check.
If you look, typically when you purchase a property, if you purchased it, there should be a residential disclosure statement where it checks off on the second box down. It'll have if the prior owner knows anything about any issues with water, sewer, backup, that type of thing.
Okay.
So if you can get us a copy of that, and also might want to get a copy of any type of inspection report you had from when you purchased the property.
Okay.
So if you have that, and if I can think of anything else, I'll email you.
Okay.
Because I have your email address. So I just want to make sure we have everything that we have so we can make a decision on the merits of what you're asking
As fast as possible.
Would you like me to bring those two documents to the October meeting, or would you like me to scan them?
You can just email them to me. Email them to me directly. Email them to me directly. I'll get them to the law department. I'll get them to Mr. McGill, Mr. Katora, and Patty.
Yeah, it'd be preferable that you get them to us as soon as possible.
Yeah, okay. Sounds good.
They have all the information they need as they do their research.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you so much.
Thank you all. I appreciate it.
Thanks for
coming.
Okay.
Thank you. Moving on to other projects reports. John?
Yes, our Bainbridge Road sidewalk project, those plans are being finalized, and that project will advertise for construction starting tomorrow. We do have several projects under construction, those being the Richmond Road resurfacing project, which is substantially complete. I would expect that we'll be doing a walkthrough here soon with the Village of Oakwood. Our Roxbury Storm Sewer Replacement Project, as well as our Cochran Road Reconstruction Project Phase 2. That project is just about Cochran Road project's just about halfway completed, and we would expect that we'll be switching traffic there to reconstruct the other two lanes, the two northbound lanes here within the next couple weeks. I also did want to share with the committee the couple pictures of the cabinet from the Cannon and Harper intersection. So as we had discussed previously or earlier in the meeting tonight, the Cannon and Harper intersection there was an accident there that destroyed our traffic signal cabinet. This is looking at the bottom of the cabinet. This actually would be the portion here that would be mounted to the concrete foundation. Just as a matter of reference, this is the electric service and the electric meter to service the cabinet. And this is another view of the cabinet, bottom of the cabinet again here. This is the portion that would be attached to the foundation. You can see some of the sealants that would go against that joint. So this was the original cabinet. As part of the citywide traffic signal project, we had added this side cabinet, which is a UPS cabinet, which adds battery backup for uninterruptible power supply in the event that the power goes out. So we still have functionality of the signal.
Did the driver have insurance?
The initial report was kind of unclear whether they did, but we've turned this all over to the prosecutor's office and are in the process of getting some estimates through the traffic repair contractor for the prosecutor's office to pursue reimbursement.
Okay. Thank
you, John.
So if there's any other questions on the report, I can address those now.
Okay, any questions? Moving on to item number 15, we have a sidewalk repair program update. We have a balance of $17,762.15. So we will keep the original contract number in mind of $95,000. And we'll keep that in mind for our budgetary concerns for 2018. And we will look at the work that was done this year and make sure that we have a comparable amount of work done next year. And are there any questions for Dan from the committee?
Mm-mm.
Okay.
Very good.
Thank you. Item 16 is the 2017 annual emergency road repair program update. $25,974.60 was performed in August. We have a $267,459.05 balance remaining on the contract. Dan, is there anything you'd like to point out on this?
No, nothing special. The ones are Cleveland Water Break repair that we did this month, and two were following behind catch basin repairs. We have the crew's going to be doing some work tomorrow on Liberty Road, Aurora Road, replacing some concrete caps and doing some asphalt work, and then finishing up a little piece of Station Street.
Okay, any questions from the committee? Seeing none, item 17 is the 2016 Sanitary and Storm System Repair Program. We have a lot of work. Mike, thank you for the photos tonight. They were very helpful. And I think that Trax did a real good job on those projects, and you did a good job managing those projects. So we have a balance of $229,963.46 left on this contract. The original contract was $400,000, which is our amount to keep in mind for next month's discussion and a list of the repairs. Does anyone on the committee have any questions? Moving on to 18, Water Reclamation Department report. Paul.
Brought some show and tell stuff tonight. I figured I'd give you an update on the project. As you know, they started the project approximately a month ago. This is the section of the plant that we're going to have that's construction is under right now, is this section right here behind the generator. That's our emergency backup generator. So these are just some photos of what this area looks like now. They came in and wiped all those trees out in virtually 2 days. They had everything leveled, all the trees removed. This is going to be over a 20-foot deep hole. This is going to be where the equalization tank is going to sit. This area here is right in the dead center of the hole. It's funny, you get a whole different perspective once they start digging. I mean, when you're looking at prints, you have no idea what this is going to be when you start looking at it. And then when they really start digging, it's like, wow, I didn't envision that. This is a little better picture of this stake is actually the center, going to be the center of the tank. And obviously this is looking over the plant. This used to be a big hillside here. So they've taken that whole hillside away just to get access to dig down as deep as they need to go. This is looking from the north side of the plant, looking back towards the hill. So this is almost down to the level that they're digging down now. And this is a big mound of dirt that they're piling up right now just to put the spoils. So when the project initially started, I was saying, hey, if you don't need to cut down all those trees, don't cut them down. He says, well, I think we're going to need them all. And I was very skeptical, but it's clear that they needed that entire area. So just thought I'd give a little update. Not a lot to look at, but you kind of see the magnitude of the big project that they're doing.
It's progress.
Yeah.
Good for you.
Okay, thank you, Paul. Item 19 is the Service Department report. Bruce, anything you'd like to point out?
Yeah, I just wanted to let all the residents know that the truck trap program will be ending at the end of September so we can move into leaf mode. Leaf pickup will begin October 15th as it does annually every year. And then I do have one announcement. We did promote somebody to assistant service director, and Mr. Mark Holly is our new assistant service director. So I want to congratulate him, and I want to say a big thank you to all the applicants that put in for it. They made my decision very difficult. Moving forward, Mark Holly will be our assistant director.
Okay, and how long has he been with the department?
Mark has been with the department, I believe, since 98, give or take.
Okay.
So he's been in management from he started on second shift, moved to streets, and now is solid waste. So he's had his tour around all the divisions, and we're confident that he could do a great job as the assistant.
Could you bring him to us and introduce him to us next meeting?
Yes, I will. Actually, he will become, the title becomes official the last pay period of September, so next Good. Meeting he will be here.
Do we have to vote on that, or?
No.
Okay.
Who will be covering his duties on solid waste?
He's going to be doing dual duty. We're going to be posting the manager's position here shortly, and hopefully I can get somebody in place to take care of that. And another internal promotion, so that's what we try to do, promote from within.
But in the meantime, in the event we have a solid waste issue, we can still contact Mr. Holly.
Yes, he will still be the contact person.
Okay. All right, motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Proceed to vote.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mr. McGill?
Yes.
Mr. Pelonis?
Yes.